Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the final Pint of Science 2021 show brought to you by Team Nottingham. I am your host, Michaela Brown, a PhD student from the University of Nottingham, and I am so excited to introduce you to tonight's show. Please let us know in the comment section where you're all tuning in from tonight. We would love to hear from you. We are, of course, sad not to be in our usual collection of Nottingham City Centre pubs and bars for this evening's festival, but we do hope we've made up for it with our fantastic lineup of guests this evening. Although we are at home, I have come prepared with a pint, and this is a great opportunity for you to quickly grab yourself a pint, a gin, or even a cup of tea, and get yourself comfortable for the start of the show. This evening, we will be exploring the art of mental health. Looking after our mental health has never been more important given the current climate, and thankfully it is becoming more widely discussed in today's society. Tonight, we will be hearing from two leading experts about how they have collaborated with the creative industry to communicate the latest brain and wellbeing research. At halftime, we have an exciting Sci-Art section of the show where we will be showing you a 15-minute video by international performance and video artist Vena Naskrecka. To finish off the show, we will then be taking a few questions from you, our wonderful audience. So get ready to pop your questions in the comment section during and at the end of the show, and we will try our best to answer as many questions as possible. Well, without further ado, let's get this show started. So, kicking off tonight's show is Professor Paul Crawford. He is from the Institute of Mental Health at the University of Nottingham, and he will be speaking about the campaign he led to support young people's mental health during the pandemic by collaborating with the creators of Wallace and Gromit. So, grab your drink as I welcome the first guest of the show, Professor Paul Crawford. Over to you, Paul.
What's up with everyone? It's the title of the talk, and it's also kind of a question, I guess. We've had a hard time with COVID, haven't we? So hopefully this short talk will perk you up a little bit. What's up with everyone is a campaign that I've led with funding from the Arts and Humanities Research Council with Aardman. Yeah, you can't beat a bit of Gromit or a bit of Shaun the Sheep. And we've teamed up with this iconic creative industry to put together some resources, some animations for young people with young people. Okay, so let me just give you a few details about this. It's all to do with mental health. It's all to do with facing and dealing with life's difficult challenges. The project team was funded by just under £1 million, a 30-month project, and our team cut across a number of universities, Nottingham, Loughborough, London School of Economics, with Aardman and our various partners, particularly Mental Health Foundation. And we worked with 42 young people who co-created five short new animations dealing with key areas of challenge in their lives that they felt that they wanted to convey to other young people. And our five young people in the project, they actually voiced the characters. So that's really important. We didn't go for actors, we went for our young people. And as part of the research background to the project, we appointed two research fellows and we have four PhD students involved. So there you go, there's the five characters, Ty, Merv, Ashley, Charlie and Alex. And just go to whatsupwitheveryone.com and you will see the animations there. And the animations are also on Aardman's YouTube channel. So there's no excuse. It's on Instagram, it's on TikTok, it's on Facebook. You can get it. So we're just going to watch one of the videos, the one dealing with perfectionism with the character Charlie. Okay, great. So that was Charlie, and the other characters do go and have a look at those films. They deal in other themes such as loneliness and isolation, which is very topical, obviously, given COVID, but also competitiveness, independence, and social media. And as you'll see on this slide, our reach since February has been amazing, with 30 million on Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, 5 million young people, 500,000 engaged with the content and posted from Aardman channels. Site traffic on the website, 38,000, going up about 1,000 a week. And we've had lots of TV, radio, and other press coverage. It's been an amazing year. We've also had, as typical with Aardman, you know, they're so well connected, we've had lots of celebrity influence. Stephen Fry, bless him, with his 12 million followers. Who has 12 million followers? Obviously, Stephen Fry. Alex George, you'll remember from Love Island, now he's involved in young people's mental health, and Michael Chakraverty from Bake Off, and so many more. So hopefully there'll be even more by the end of this session. Further promotional support for the campaign has come from WHO, Public Health England, and lots of different organisations, particularly those involved in mental health, students, universities, schools, colleges, and so on. So we're grateful for all of them for getting involved and getting this stuff out there. The preliminary findings from the research side have been really positive. So these animations, which have been co-created with young people for young people, we've learned that they improve young people's knowledge of mental health, their willingness to seek help, and their confidence in helping others. And currently our research is looking at the role of digital storytelling in mental health literacy, trust in the online materials, really important, and evaluation of the films and the platform generally. So far, we've got two publications out there, a scoping review on digital video interventions for mental health, and one from me on the whole business of lockdown and the mental health impacts of lockdown on young people and how this project fits into that. In terms of policy engagement, we've really worked hard on this because governments need to know that young people's mental health should be right at the top of the agenda. We've learned recently from the ONS that young people's mental health has deteriorated significantly over the last winter lockdown. So we got the briefings on the project out to ministers, all the ministers and all MPs. We've briefed key committees, and we've had key ministers involved promoting the campaign, including the Minister of State for Universities, Michelle Donnellan. That's my email, paul.crawford@nottingham.ac.uk. That's a little picture of me down at Aardman Studios with Morph. Some of you may remember that wonderful character that started the whole Aardman enterprise. So thank you for joining me this evening. I hope you got a few questions, and I hope you enjoy the rather, I think, captivating art performance from Vena Naskrecka next.
Oh, thank you so much, Paul, for your fascinating insight into how you have been trying your best to help young people's mental health in this pandemic. We're so sorry to both you and to our audience, because it seems as though we had a couple of technical issues with the little video clip that you had. But if you would like to watch it later on, we have posted a link in the comment section. Please do go and have a look at that after the show. And of course, as Paul's mentioned, if you do have any questions, please do pop your questions into the comment section. And at the end of the show, Paul will try and answer as many of these as possible. We will now be introducing our halftime video from Vena Naskrecka. So Vena is an international performance and video artist who has paired up with Paul for this year's Sci-Art section of the show. And I've seen in the comments section that she is tuning in from Iceland tonight. So good evening, Vena. Thank you for joining us. She has composed a video for us, and the video aims to convey the psychological impact of eczema. And you will hear that there is a voiceover as well. And this voiceover is actually the voice of Paul, who has been reacting to the video unscripted to Vena's performance. Please enjoy.
I am a child with old hands. The children look at me. Touch my hand. I am so dry. I am dry. I am so dry. I am a child with old hands. I hide my hands. I pull down my sleeves. I sit on my hands. My old, dry hands. Children laugh. They laugh when my skin falls to the ground, when my skin breaks from me like leaves, like snow, like ash. They never let me into the sports hall. They don't want my skin. Let me harvest what has fallen. I will not lose me. I bring myself together. The children watch. What are you doing? I am a child with old hands. Look at my skin. I am a child. With old hands. My skin is cracked. Like kintsugi. I want a new skin. I want a new armor. I don't want to be the child with old hands. Make me new, make me new, make me new. Transform me. Then the children will play with me. Transform me. Make me golden. Now they will love me. Now they can see me. The child with old hands. with new skin, with old hands.
Wow. Well, thank you so much, Vena, for such a thought-provoking video for our event tonight. If you are tuning in a little bit later and you weren't too sure what the video was about, Vena was looking to explore the experience, both physically and psychologically, of young children who experience skin conditions such as eczema. So thank you very much, Vena, for producing your video for our show tonight. If you would like to see more of Vena's creations, you can head to her website, which is being shown on the screen now. So moving on to our final speaker of the night. Our final guest speaker this evening is Professor Justine Schneider, who is also from the University of Nottingham. She will be speaking about her collaborations with creative artists to represent her research to non-academic audiences via film, cartoons, podcasts, and even opera. So raise a glass and welcome our final guest of the show, Professor Justine Schneider. Over to you, Justine.
Thanks, and I have to say I'm still reeling from that wonderful performance that Vena and Paul gave us. I think it's a great introduction to my talk because it helps us to understand how the arts can affect us emotionally. And really, as an academic, my job has always been to write papers. I'm not getting my presentation screen at the moment, but I'm going to keep trying. So, this is the work of academics. We are asked to publish papers. I wonder how I go back to my presentation. Any ideas, folks?
Just give us a few moments while we try and work out some technical issues. Sorry, everybody. Sometimes it's the way when we're working virtually, but we'll get there. So give us a few minutes. Thank you.
Thanks. So the title, I'll just talk while they're doing that, but the title of my talk today is Why Publish Papers? And it's a really great opportunity for me to say some things tonight that I haven't got the ability to say in other forums when I'm working as an academic. Tonight I want to give you some examples of the work that I've done in the past and maybe stimulate some ideas for other people to work through the arts to communicate the... I'm going back to my Google page and I will... open my file again, and that should get us to the presentation again. We left it open earlier, but it's been overtaken by events, I think. Lovely. Are you getting the presentation now, I hope? Because I can tell you what I'm talking about.
We can. We got there. Thank you very much.
So you'll be from, there's a difference. Oh, wait a minute. Let me go back. Okay. So many academics say that the goal of their research is to publish their results, and they do this in academic papers. And the scientific enterprise proceeds by the creation of knowledge that adds to pre-existing information we have about the world. But I'm a social scientist, and social sciences have adopted a similar standard of academic publications, credibility, but I think that they really want to act upon the world in other ways. Academics are judged by their papers, but there's a difference between the fields of the natural sciences and the social sciences. In the natural sciences, the object of study is the physical world and how it operates. By contrast, I think the social sciences look at human behavior and the interaction of people and groups. So where do we as human beings learn about our place in the world? Well, we learn from stories about other people. We have an innate attraction to stories, the stuff of fiction and drama. And I've been doing social research and publishing papers for 30 years, and typically working with teams of colleagues on problems affecting stigmatized and disadvantaged groups.
Sorry to interrupt you, Justine. I just wanted to quickly ask if you could please put yourself in presentation mode. It's quite hard for us to see what you're presenting to us. So we're currently got you in editing mode.
That's where we're going. I'm so sorry.
No problem. Oh, we're back. No, perfect. Thank you so much.
So most recently, I've been working in the field of dementia, and I don't want my work to stop at the point of publication. I want it to make a difference to people, and I think it can have an impact if it reaches the people we're studying, the subjects of our research, and also the people who have power over those stigmatized and marginalized groups. But we need to make sure that all of these people can engage with our research. We can't assume that they will subscribe to journals or even read the popular press. And so towards the end of my academic career, I've stopped counting papers like many academics, and I've begun to adopt alternative ways of communicating research. So the first output arose from a study in which we adapted acute hospital wards to take better care of patients with dementia. Once the research funding to make those changes had come to an end, the wards were threatened with closure, and I suggested that we document their operation in a film. Owen Davis was commissioned to make the short film Today is Monday, and it's an observational documentary recording a day in the life of the ward. It was done without narration. It was done with permission from the NHS, the patients, and their proxies. And the patients in this film speak for themselves. The staff speak for themselves. There's a very moving moment when this gentleman with dementia turns to the camera and asks if the cameraman can explain why he finds himself in this ward. A second study went back to the hospital to look at the staff experience of caring for people with dementia on closed wards, where staff who are low paid and who have no nursing qualifications actually do most of the work with people, the direct work with patients, the feeding, the washing, the dressing. So three researchers shown in this picture went to work on the wards while they observed what went on and wrote about it. We found, among other things, that the patient-facing staff had impressive skills in relating to people with dementia, that the team in the workplace was vitally important, and that the wards actually operated with a very tight choreography that in fact excluded most of the medical staff, whom I, as an outsider, might have assumed had some influence in what happened in a hospital. Tanya Myers wrote and directed a 2-hour play called Inside Out of Mind, based on our research finding. She also brought to it her own experience and a year of research and development. The director of nursing at Nottingham City Hospital then commissioned us to perform that play to all 900 of her nurses and healthcare assistants. She even gave them time off to go to the theatre as part of their rota. The play went on to tour to 6 cities and has been seen live by about 10,000 people. Well, the reach is not as great as What's Up With People, but we think it has made an impact just the same. We carefully monitored audience reactions, and we conducted an independent survey of the messages that people took away from the show. And of course, we avidly read the reviews like any performers. I next applied for research funding for a study about home care for people with dementia. Encouraged this time by the impact of Inside Out of Mind and departing from academic tradition, I included a budget in that grant application for arts-based dissemination. This £20,000 enabled us to commission 3 new works from different artists, which were all based on the findings of the study. Elspeth Penny, who's a playwright, wrote a comic play, which has evolved into a podcast. It's called Silver Linings Care Plan. Elspeth is the second from the left in this picture. And the podcast has now been recorded with a cast of household names. That was one of the bonuses of lockdown and the wonderful funding that the Arts Council generated to keep a lot of artists fed and clothed. And we hope that the podcast will soon be broadcast. A second work was drawn by the cartoonist Tony Husband. This is a graphic novel called Winston's World. Tony had previously published a very moving cartoon account of his father's journey with dementia. And we commissioned him to draw Winston's World, which is actually based on a cat's eye view of five typical scenarios in caring for people with dementia at home. This 90-page book is intended to be a training tool for home care workers. And the third piece is by composer Douglas Finch. Douglas has produced a score of an opera with Cindy Oswin writing the libretto. I think this is probably the first opera based on dementia care, and we hope to produce it at Lakeside Theatre in Nottingham next April and to tour it subsequently. So I'm really looking forward to the teamwork and excitement of another creative production. And most of all, I'm looking forward to filling the auditorium with people who are engaged with the narrative of the work, engaged with their hearts as well as with their minds. Because in a live show, people sit and focus long enough, I think, to understand some of the complex reality that we've been studying. Because in doing all this, we want to improve dementia care and awareness. I think that the mechanisms to do this include empathy on the part of family carers and paid professionals, empathy towards individuals with dementia, but also empathy towards each other. The arts create time and space for us to understand people well enough to empathize with them and to know things often, as Vena showed us, without the need to express them in words. As participants in live performance, we can experience, for example, how it feels to visit your wife on a ward and find her kissing another man. Or we can explore how it feels to be treated like an object instead of a human being because you have dementia. Most importantly, perhaps, we can see on stage or on screen people communicating effectively with other people despite the obstacle of dementia. Communication is at the heart of dementia care, and we can read about this on a page, but we remember it much better when we see the message embodied and enacted before our eyes. And since most of us will care for someone with dementia at some point in our life, we will need to remember what good care looks like. At the end of the day, this is why I have turned to narratives and their artistic presentation. Academic papers tell readers about dementia care, but the arts can show us not only what good or indeed bad care looks like, but how it feels. And powerful feelings help to seal important messages into our memory.
Wow. Well, thank you so much, Justine. That was so fascinating. And it really is amazing what kind of outreach you can have when you turn to the creative side of things and the creative side of communication, communicate important things like dementia to the wider population, because you're absolutely right. I think, you know, academia is a very, very small bubble, and it's so important to kind of break through that bubble and find avenues of communicating research to everyone around us. So thank you so much for sharing. And, you know, if anyone enjoyed Justine's talk, do look out for any kind of future collaborations and future shows you'll be having both in Nottingham and outside. So now we are going to the Q&A section of the show. So I'm really pleased to welcome back both of our guests, Paul and Justine, for the Q&A section this evening. Hello, welcome back. If anyone in the audience does have any last minute questions, please do remember to pop them in the comment section and we will try to get to as many of them as we can. So kick us off with the first question. This is from Jellyhead. So, Paul, how did you choose the young people to co-produce the films? They also think that collaboration with Aardman is a fab idea.
Well, you're right, it is a fab idea. And so we established links with multiple colleges and schools, universities with Aardman and recruited the 42 larger or outer group to help to formulate ideas around the life's challenges, basically. What young people felt that they were struggling with. So we didn't go into a hardline mental health, mental health and diagnostics. It was all about life's challenges. And those young people contributed to the frame of the ideas around those themes. And then five of the young people in an inner group, they were then contributing to the scripts and the voices. So Aardman created this. That's what Aardman do. Creature Comforts, Wallace and Gromit, and
absolutely,
yeah.
Yeah, no, definitely. And just a reminder for everyone from the video earlier, the Charlie video, please do have a look into the comment section because you can have a look at the video there with sound because as Paul has mentioned, the voiceovers and the sounds really are quite interesting and quite good to listen to. We will have a couple more questions. So the next question we've got is from Phil. So Phil is wondering if you think labelling mental health, such as depression, is helpful or detrimental to someone's mental health. They also want to know what the best way is to accept a mental health diagnosis. And this question can go to either of you. I don't know, Justine, if you have any opinions on this, you can go first.
I don't have any problems with using terminology that is widely understood and helps people to access help. Because if I had disturbing feelings and couldn't call them depression, I wouldn't know where to turn for help. So I think that although labelling is sometimes used in a derogatory way, I think we need language to communicate about our mental health issues as well as any other aspect of life.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. What do you think about it, Paul?
Yeah, well, I kind of just think back a little bit to the art performance with Vena, really. So I've got eczema. I am the child with old hands. So that's how things were for me at school. And I've got used to saying I've got eczema when that's appropriate. I've got eczema. And similar with what we call mental health disorders or mental health challenges, diagnoses. I've got depression. I've got eczema. I've got depression. And that's where I take it. In terms of accepting mental health diagnosis, it does depend on the person, whether they feel that the diagnosis is doing something which is distressing to them or perhaps limiting their life in some way, or they feel somehow kind of stereotyped through that or positioned or perceived in a different way through that. So I don't know if I would say you should accept diagnoses in that sense. Perhaps it's something for you to consider why it causes some disquiet or discomfort for you.
For sure, that's such an interesting point. And I mean, as you say, like you've grown up now and you find it so normal to let people know that you've got eczema. And I guess the hope in society moving forward that we have the same kind of normalization with mental health and in terms of it being okay to talk about if you do have a diagnosis and that being accepted by the people around you and definitely making it less of a taboo subject. And I think, in time, I think we'll definitely get there and people will be more comfortable with talking about it and perhaps in turn even accepting that they do have something like that.
The question also asked, what's the best way to accept a mental health diagnosis? And I think I would really recommend talking to other people with a similar diagnosis. There are a lot of good peer support groups online and in different places. Mm-hmm. But you need to relate to people who have an experience that's like yourself, and that helps to understand and to humanize the experience.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, I couldn't agree more with you. And I mean, it kind of relates a little bit to Paul's talk in terms of, like, you know, mental health. Currently, we're looking at mainly clinical avenues to help deal with mental health. And, you know, both of you are really touching on, well, you know, how important can creative and animations be for improving mental health? And Paul, I mean, what do you think? Do you think that animations and the creatives could be as important as clinical approaches for improving mental health moving forward?
Well, I think mental health is far too important to leave to mental health professionals, and there's simply not enough of them to go around. You know, you can see from waiting lists. So my view is that, you know, arts and humanities, reading, writing, singing, dancing, you know, theatre, as Justine's actually presented, all of these things are like a shadow health service. They are. You know, they're part of the health of the nation. And we've seen that in lockdown, people have got very creative to actually deal with the psychological challenge of being indoors for so long. So that's the way I see it. We need clinicians, you know, we need therapies, we need that type of stuff. But we also shouldn't forget that public health is creative health. And creativity, you know, we survive through it, don't we?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I mean, maybe you're right. Maybe it's just a combination of the two. And the key here really is the collaboration between the two. And it's like the other thing, it's very individualized and it's very effective for different people, what works for different people. But yeah, no, thank you very much. It's been really interesting. Do we have any more questions? So Lynn, I'm wondering if this might be also directed at you, Paul. So Lynn is wondering, first of all, they think your outreach is fantastic, and they wanted to know what outcomes are you planning to measure?
Yeah, great question, Lynn. I think fantastic initiative also applies to Justine's work.
Oh, but, absolutely.
You know, the Aardman project has really benefited from Aardman. I mean, you know, when I was sat in the Aardman offices with Oscars and pictures of Wallace and Gromit, and I started to think about how we can impact an outreach. I mean, once Aardman gave me the short list of all their influencers and celebrities, I just had to go for a cup of tea. I mean, game over. In terms of outcomes, well, we're looking at how these films can act as a kind of creative public health, mm-hmm. how the co-constructed informations and the platform can upstream, not downstream, upstream support our young people when they're in a transition period between school and university or college or the workplace. So we're measuring mental health literacy with colleagues at London School of Economics. We're looking at how the stories and digital storytelling impact on participants. We're looking at, through youth juries, we're looking at how the films impact on the viewer, the young person viewer. And we're also investigating with young people the level of trust and the information they need to trust online informations, like our own platform and films.
Wow, interesting. Okay, perfect. Do we have any other questions? Let me have a quick read through. So Andy Brown, so he's got a question and he's wondering, how would you approach someone you believe may have a mental health issue, but they are not self-aware? Justine, I can see you thinking, would you like to give this one a go?
That's a terrible question. It's such a difficult one, isn't it? I definitely wouldn't talk about mental health. I definitely wouldn't ask about how they were feeling. I would just get alongside them and spend some time with them and experience their world and just be there for them.
Yeah, I think that's right, Justine. And, you know, I think when we feel that somebody is acting or behaving in a way that seems odd. I mean, that happens in general life anyway, not necessarily because of mental health challenges. But if we feel perhaps the person is in, you know, a level of distress, or their behavior may be, you know, concerning for them and for others, then I think that needs some careful handling. I've always found that the best route with this, unless it's an emergency situation, of course, that's different, but it is to talk and to consider what's happening with the person in, you know, depending on the level of challenge. So, you know, more brains are better than one, you know, and don't just jump in and start acting like a psychologist or a psychiatrist or a counsellor. Just do what Justine said and just walk with them a bit or be with them and see where the conversation together goes.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think there's a lot he said about just being present for someone who you think maybe isn't kind of behaving like themselves. I think definitely people need support and just being around them can definitely help. So, you know, thank you for that. That was really helpful. We have one more question. So this is from Anthony, and he is wondering if you have a definition of what mental health is. Of course, in life, we have ups and downs, and not everyone is happy all the time. And do you think being contented is good enough?
Brilliant question. Brilliant question. I don't believe in happiness in that sense. I mean, certainly not as a consistent or constant thing. I think most of our lives we're trying to find, you know, that balance and trying to find contentment or, you know, sometimes we get joy coming in and bursts of ecstasy and great when that happens. I would say a definition of mental good health for me would be not having to monitor and consider distress and trauma on a regular basis, you know, because on a day-to-day basis, I want to be clear of that ruminating and worrying about everything and so on. So that would be fine for me.
I think it's important to recognize that we can all take control of our mental health, that we all have some influence in how our mental health flourishes, that it's very important to get enough sleep, to get good nutrition, to think positive thoughts, to get exercise. We take care of our brains and our mental well-being as well as we take care of our body.
You know what? Virtual events, honestly, we're experiencing all kind of virtual experiences you can imagine, from doorbells, postage, postman deliveries, microphones being muted. It's an adventure. I'm happy we can all be experiencing this together. It's been our lockdown life for about a year now in the UK, so
yeah. Sorry, that was Amazon.
But yeah, no, thank you so much, everyone, for all of your questions this evening. I'm not sure we have any more questions, but it really has been such an enjoyable time to be your host tonight. Of course, thank you to both Justine and to Paul for your very insightful talks. If anyone would like to find out more about any of their research, you can go to the University of Nottingham website and look up their names. Just a little reminder for you as well about Paul's short video. If you are still tuning in, we will quickly show you that video now, for the video that was muted earlier on. So stay tuned for that.
So that's it then. I've missed the grade. All my dreams are trash. I'm obviously a total failure. All those showers I took instead of revising, I will never shower again. This is where I live now, in the bin of shame, along with all this other rubbish. Oh god, that smells. I can't even get wallowing in a bin right. slides. Yikes.
So thank you everyone for being so patient this evening with all of our technical difficulties. So a big thank you to our guest speakers, Paul and Justine, for your talk, and of course to Vena for her halftime show. That wraps up tonight's show. It has been an absolute pleasure to be your host this evening, and I do hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have. This is, of course, our final evening of live events for this year's Pint of Science Festival, but do not worry. This event, along with the events that have been broadcast live over the last few nights, will be available for you to watch on YouTube at your leisure. Thank you, everyone behind the scenes as well, who has helped organise this year's event. And thank you very much to everyone for tuning in. And hopefully, we will see you again next year, and this time in person with a pint and in a pub. Thank you very much, and good night.